Some 2,000 years ago, the disciples came to Christ and they said, Jesus, teach us how to pray. Today on Better Life Today Bible Study, we're going to look at that passage in Matthew. Stay tuned. Hi, welcome to Better Life Today Bible Study. Today, as always, or as usual, I'm with my co-director, Sean Murphy.
Good to be here.
And my good friend and Bible worker, Chuck Austin. And of course, I'm Kip Bradford. Today, we're talking about prayer. And specifically, we're talking about prayer as Christ relayed the method or a method, some principles for praying to the disciples. And that was some 2,000 years ago. Mm-hmm. And so let's just start and read this prayer. We call it the Lord's Prayer. We're all familiar with it. Mm-hmm. And if you want to follow along, we're using the New King James Version. And it's Matthew 6, starting in verses 9. And Christ says, in this manner, therefore, pray. And then he continues, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name, or hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us that this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now, you notice I stumbled a few times because I memorized this as a kid in the King James. Right. And so my mind is wanting to fill in the few different way that it reads. Yeah, yeah. But let's just you know, take this passage apart.
Sounds good.
And of course, the first verse there, or the first part, is Our Father in Heaven. Mm-hmm. What strikes me to start with is that Christ didn't say, My Father in Heaven, mm-hmm. Our Father. He was including the disciples, mm-hmm. the believers, you and me, in that statement, Our Father.
Right. And he tells us where the Father is, because what was very common in those days, pagan worship all around the Israelites were the only ones that were the worship of the true God. So he wants to distinguish where God, his Father, is. He's in heaven.
Right. Which is important.
Yeah.
When we think of God, we recognize he's in heaven on his throne. Right. The one and only God.
Amen.
And of course, the pagans, they had all their gods of graven images.
They were polytheistic, yep.
And right. I think the other thing, too, that that is conveyed here is, I'm a loving Father. And he wants us to know also, yes, he's in heaven, but also he wants to be intimately involved in our lives.
Sure.
So that's the picture he wants to paint. In fact, Isaiah 49:15, we don't necessarily have to go there, but basically he's saying, you know, even can a mother forget her own? She might, but I will never forget you. So the idea of showing that he's a loving father is something that he wants to convey as well.
Right. Well, and I appreciate just the word father. You know, mm-hmm. God is king. He didn't say our king.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You know, he said our father. That's mm-hmm. an intimate phrase.
Right, intimate.
And then hallowed be your name. Mm-hmm. You know, his name is holy. You think of mm-hmm. of Moses in the burning bush. Mm-hmm. And take off your shoes, which was a practice. We take off our hats mm-hmm. here in the West. Right. You know, we're going to pray, going to a church or whatever, we take off our hats. Mm-hmm. But in that culture, we take off our shoes.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You know?
Yeah, and our names aren't holy, but his name is.
But his name is.
It's be spoken with reverence, right. Not lightly.
Right.
And in fact, back in those times, the name was so holy that it was either spoken either with complete just reverence and awe, or it was not spoken whatsoever.
Right.
It was a name to where they were not wanting sometimes to even speak it out at all.
Right. And not a day goes by where we don't hear from the world people using God's name in ways that is not reverent.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Right.
True.
You know, just as second nature, just using the Lord's name in vain. And it's gotten to the point where I don't even think a lot of folks really even recognize they're doing it. It's just a common way to speak of God. Yep. But we have a God, a mighty God, who's sitting on a throne in heaven, who is our Father, who has a holy name that we should speak in reverence. Mm-hmm. And yes, I agree, you know, or not speak it at all. Mm-hmm. And so how many times, and you know, I used to, back in the day, I was a truck driver.
Uh-oh.
Before I started doing other things and came to the ministry, but I drove truck. And it was interesting because I don't typically use poor language. And being around truck drivers, sometimes they can be a little rough, you know. And it was always interesting to me that I would be standing in a circle of truckers getting ready to get a load from a lumber mill or something like that. And there'd be a couple that I knew because we tend to bump into each other at these places, and some that I wouldn't. Somebody would just be cursing up a storm, and the other guy would say, "Don't." He would defend God. Mm. I wouldn't even do it. Mm. He would defend God, and he says, "Kip's a Christian." And they would tone it down.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Although it is a shame that oftentimes we find ourselves in that situation and we aren't the ones that speak up.
Right.
Someone else.
And we can speak up in love.
Right.
Right.
Amen.
We don't have to speak up in a hateful way.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So those are lessons that we can learn, I suppose.
Mm-hmm. So in the Bible, the one thing that that's really key, when you say name, to me, like my son, his name is Kieran, which means small and dark. Well, he's neither of the two. so the meaning of his name really wasn't the key. We just liked the name. Mm-hmm. So we named him Kieran. Right. But in the Bible, name meant character. In fact, maybe we can just kind of quickly go to Exodus 34 and read verses 5-7. Now the Lord descended in the cloud and stood with him there and proclaimed the name of the Lord. And the Lord passed before him and proclaimed. Remember, the name was proclaimed.
Mm-hmm. Right. Mm-hmm.
So here's the proclamation. The Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abounding in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, by no means clearing the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children and the children's children to the third and fourth generation. So it's interesting because the name of the Lord was proclaimed, and then it says, here's the proclamation, goodness and mercy and truth.
Mm-hmm. Right.
It's his character, right?
And to use his name in a disrespectful way, I mean, how could you do that when this is what his name means?
Mm-hmm. Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This is who God is.
Mm-hmm. Right.
In Scripture, name does mean a great deal. And I think of when Jacob wrestled with God, and at the end of that wrestling match, God says, "What's your name?" And then he changed his name. He said his name was Jacob. Jacob meant the usurper.
Right.
And then he said, so Jacob said, you know, I'm the usurper, I'm the deceiver.
Right.
And God said, from now on, you're going to be Israel.
Yeah. One who wrestles with God and prevails.
And Amen. One who wrestles with God and prevails. Amen. Okay, let's go back to Matthew 6. And this is your kingdom come. This is the desire of each one of us in this room, I believe.
Yes.
And we do know that as believers, his kingdom has come in us.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And so we desire that for all those who are watching, for all those who are coming to a decision for him. But we also recognize that time is short, and his kingdom's going to come physically.
Right. Yeah. Amen.
Your will be done. Now that's interesting. Your will be done. So we're to pray for God's will.
Right. And I like the next phrase. I think they go together. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
On earth
How is God's will done in heaven?
Exactly how God wants it.
Exactly. Perfectly, yeah. It sure isn't done that way here, is it? Right. But that's what his desire is for us.
Right.
And if we abide in Christ, it can be that way. But only as we abide in Christ.
Right. Sure. And we spend, as Christians who are still learning how to communicate and to find unity with God, because we're always wrestling the flesh, aren't we?
Mm-hmm.
And so it seems like I am anyway.
Mm-hmm.
And We spend a great deal of time trying to persuade God to our will.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, we sure do. Yeah.
And we should be resting in His will, right, whatever that might be. Right. And that's a scary thing to say. When you think of the human side of us, right, because God's will might not line up with our will, but I believe that when we line our will up with God's will, mm-hmm, when we find that unity, we say, whatever, Lord, mm-hmm, even though it scares us to death sometimes, mm-hmm, I believe that we'll find true joy in His will. Mm-hmm. Right. Yep. Even if there's true suffering in His will,
right,
it'll still be joy.
Right. I think also that there's people that kind of think of as God, as His will for us is that we would just be subdued and give everything up and give everything to me. And I think that's vital, that's important. But some people look at it like, but God wants me to have nothing. He wants me to be nothing. And so John 10:10 actually says, we don't have to turn there. I'll just say it real quick. But it says, you know, the enemy comes to steal and to kill and destroy. But I have come that they may have life and have it more abundantly. So I think that's also, because up in heaven, I will tell you this much, God is not up in heaven saying, don't live to the fullest. Mm-hmm. No. Up in heaven, it's joy, and it's just this amazing thing. And they're living life to the very fullest. Right. And so the idea of heaven, or on earth as it is in heaven, He's wanting everybody to live to the absolute fullest. Mm-hmm. But the fullest is within His will. And then we, in turn, just give Him praise back.
Amen.
And so I think that's something that's really big, too, is God's not saying, if you're within my will, I'm going to stuff you down. No, He's saying it's going to be abundant.
Right.
Yeah, I'm going to say, too, going with what you're saying there, is that, you know, on this earth, we know that we have a great controversy going on. Satan is trying to do everything he can to distract us, to deter us, to take us away from God. Right. And just like you said, though, we will live life to the full when we are in Christ's will.
Right.
But Satan is adamantly trying to convince us otherwise. Oh, if you follow God, you can't do this. You can't do this. You can't do this. You know, but think all the things you can do. If you know. Right. And so that's that lie that's out there. And unfortunately, most of the people have bought into it. And I know our desire is for our viewing audience is for them to see that no. That is a lie. And you're going to actually enjoy life more fully. Right. As you put Christ in the center of it and let Him lead.
Right. We think of this living sacrifice, and we think of this word sacrifice as being of self-denial.
Right.
For example, I like, right now this time of year, I like pumpkin pie. Right? Mm-hmm. And there's no reason for me not to like pumpkin pie. Right. But In the common way of thinking about sacrificing ourselves, I will sacrifice my pumpkin pie. Mm-hmm. And so we think of it as self-denial of things, when it's actually lining ourselves up with God's will so that the things that we desire that are not healthy in our life become dimmed.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Not become, because if I'm excuse me, if I am sacrificing something in the sense that I'm denying myself something that I still want, mm-hmm, I haven't really given it up. I'm just not doing it.
Right. Very good.
You know, does that make sense?
Yeah, very good.
The one thing God works on, though, too, is He says, you've given me this, but watch this, Kip. I'm going to replace it with this.
Right.
And it's something so much better. So it's not like God saying, give it to me, you get nothing, and you just sit over there in the corner. But He's actually saying, you know, if you want to give me that figurative pumpkin pie, then I've got a lemon pie that's much better.
Well, I don't see much like lemon pie better.
A good apple pie.
Well, apple's not too bad either.
So 2 Corinthians 5:17 goes along with that principle. That if anyone be in Christ, he's a new creation.
Yeah.
Old things are passed away. All things become like new. So just like you said, Kip, that, you know, if we're denying ourselves, we're still wanting it. You know, we're not at the place where God wants us. We need to come to the place where the things that we know are not good for us, we don't even want them anymore.
Exactly. And then, you know, during that process of sanctification, which is a word we like to use,
mm-hmm,
is that there are times when we will stumble and go back to that pumpkin pie.
Right.
However, we have a repentive attitude, mm-hmm. recognizing after we've had the pumpkin pie, mm-hmm. that, and there's nothing wrong with pumpkin pie.
I was going to say, that's my favorite.
It's an illustration. Everything in moderation. So that we are truly repentive of and did not find the satisfaction that we had remembered fondly from our days of sin.
Mm-hmm. Right. Mm-hmm.
And then we turn back towards Christ. In the steps to Christ, the chapter "Growing in Christ," and there's a phrase in there that I really like. It says it talks about growing in His character, mm-hmm. and it says something to the effect, and it might not be word for word, that we in our life, at some point, as our characters are being perfected, mm-hmm. turn towards the Son, turn towards Christ as mm-hmm. the flower turns to the sun. It's natural.
Yeah, it's a beautiful thing.
It's not forcing ourselves to, right. Oh, I messed up. I must now turn back to some Bible study and prayer.
Right. Right.
It is, I've messed up, and I'm going to go see my Father,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
and we're going to have a conversation.
And I like the thought you shared, that book, Steps to Christ. And can I maybe throw a thought out here for our viewing audience?
Sure.
That if anybody would like a copy of that little book, Steps to Christ, you know, call in to Better Life Television. We'll make sure they get one.
Absolutely. Yeah. In fact, we'd be happy to. And call us. There will be a scroll mm-hmm. that you will be seeing going under here. Mm-hmm. And, of course, this is news to the guys in the back because we haven't done this yet. So, sorry, guys in the back. It's a scroll, and you can actually text us.
Yeah,
it's a special text number, and I set it up last night, so it'll be going. And cool, you text us, Steps to Christ. So we need your name, address, phone number, and email. And we'll be happy to send you a copy of Steps to Christ.
Yeah. Sounds good. So since we're on the subject of food, and we brought up pies and so on, let's talk about bread.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Give us this day our daily bread. Yeah. Now, I believe that that when we sit down to have our meals, you know, most of the time we thank God for our meal.
Right.
But I think that, you know, and correct me if I'm just thinking weird, but I don't think I am. I think one reason that we do that is, one, we are grateful for the food and what God supplied us. But it gives us a constant daily reminder to stop and spend some time with God. Not just to thank you for this food, bless and nourish our bodies, amen. But Lord, thank you for the day you've given me so far today. Lord, open some opportunities where I can witness for you today. It's a moment in time where God has where we have taken and saying, okay, every time we eat, we're going to remember to pray. Mm-hmm. And I think we need to add more to our prayer mm-hmm. than just thank you for this food, bless and nourish our bodies, amen. Mm-hmm.
Right. I know one of the things I do in my prayer, bless my food, is a reminder for me. I say, thank you, Lord, for providing for all my needs. It reminds me that God is the great provider, and everything, including this food, is given to me. Mm-hmm. And
So what that's doing, too, is it's taking my mind and changing it from just being about me also to realizing that everything comes from God. And I live in, and it's kind of a cliche, an attitude of gratitude.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
And if I get used to that, then that's something that's big. But to look into the spiritual sense also, I think we need to do, and that is that we're told in the book of John that Jesus says, I'm the bread of life.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that's something that's really big too, is that I'm the bread of life and you need to come to me and feed on my words.
Right.
So this is an indication of not just physical mm-hmm. food, mm-hmm. but spiritual food.
Right. Exactly. Know?
And so Denise and I make a habit when we actually pray over a meal at dinner mm-hmm. is that's when we pray together for those on our prayer list.
Neat.
We just try to remember those who we know who are sick and suffering, and we take some time to do that before we dine on the physical food. But yes, our spiritual food. Thank you, Lord, for giving us our daily spiritual food.
Right. And, the pastor that married Elton and myself, that he asked me this question. He said, Chuck, how often do you like to eat? I said, at least a couple times a day. He goes, and what if you only eat like a couple times a week? I'd probably get pretty emaciated and maybe even end up dying, you know, for lack of nutrition. And he goes, well, many people are willing to eat physical food a couple times a day, but they're only willing to eat spiritual food maybe once or twice a week.
Right.
And so the point he was trying to bring out, and less.
Right.
And what God was trying to bring out is that you can't have strong physical bodies if you don't eat regularly, but you can't have a strong spiritual relationship with God if you don't eat spiritually regularly.
Right.
And
yeah,
the point was well taken.
And I think we probably all are all guilty of experiencing some of that. And I know Sean came from the world of the medical world, you know, working with arms and limbs, doing whatever you guys do, PT stuff.
Physical therapist.
Right. There's a word that my wife came from the veterinary industry, veterinarian, and she's not a veterinarian, but that's the industry she's worked in. There's the word atrophy, where you lose your strength and your muscle tone and all that stuff, I guess.
Right.
And as you distance yourself from dining on the Word of God, you begin to spiritually atrophy.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yep.
And then that sacrifice of the pie becomes less, you know, and the old things will come back into your life.
Right.
Very often.
Mm-hmm. Right. So atrophy actually means, A, means lack of, and then trophy means development. So a lack of development. So my muscles aren't developed anymore.
Right.
So atrophy, that's what it means, just lack of development.
Sure. And when we spend time with, with any relationship, the more I spend with my wife, the better our relationship is.
Mm-hmm.
The more you and I get to know each other, the stronger our friendship becomes.
Right.
And yet, the majority of folks spend less time in the Word of God than they do with anyone else in their life.
That's right. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You do the best of time.
Yeah. Sure.
So give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Now, that's a hard one. Isn't it?
Yeah. We want the forgiveness, but
we don't necessarily want to forgive.
We want part A, but we're having a hard time with part B.
Right.
Yeah.
But they go together.
Sure.
You can't have one without the other.
Now, you know, and so what does it mean? What's a debtor? Okay, what debts do I have that God will forgive?
Mm-hmm.
Needs to forgive.
Yeah.
You know, that list is long.
Yeah, the sins that I've begun.
It's a short program, so.
Right, that's true.
We don't have time because once you're done with your list,
specific.
And Chuck has his list and I have my list.
Right.
So we'd have a long
time. But we, you know, sometimes we are not truthful. Sometimes we are not kind. Sometimes we are not loving.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes we are not giving.
Right.
There are so many times in our lives where we fail and God is faithful to forgive us. Mm-hmm. And yet, to remember that he has forgiven me so much,
mm-hmm.
and I am so often unwilling to forgive other people so little.
Right. Yeah. That's why we need to look more to Christ. And the more we look to Christ and we see his character, the more we're going to be willing to forgive.
Yeah. Right.
So Matthew actually speaks to the idea of, some people might say, well, that sounds really harsh, but it actually, it says right in there that, and it's shortly after this passage here, and it says, if you don't forgive, you can't be forgiven. But then God also says, if you confess your sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That's 1 John 1:9.
Mm-hmm.
And so he wants so badly to do that, but he's also saying, you need to have the attitude of forgiveness toward others that I have toward you.
Exactly.
Yep.
And that's a hard thing in our humanness to do.
Oh, yeah.
Yep.
You know, and what's really amazing is you know, God promises to forget them.
Mm-hmm.
And so we as humans don't forgive ourselves, and so we assume God hasn't really forgiven us, as the devil keeps bugging me about the thing I've already given to God,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
And we still feel guilty, mm-hmm. you know, that there are times when guilt is the devil's tool.
Right. That's right.
Right? Right. And so we go to God and we say, hey, forgive me for offending Sean. And God has already promised to forget it, and so my mind is thinking that he's like, what? What are you talking about, kid? You know?
Yeah.
And what's amazing to me is that a God, an infinite God, a God who has existed forever, right? Mm. Who knows everything, who made everything, who is everything to us, chooses to forget.
Mm-hmm.
Because he is incapable of forgetting without making that decision.
Right.
Right? Yeah. And there's times when I wished I could forget things, and I'm incapable of forgetting at all. Mm-hmm. And the things that I want to, and I forget all the stuff I shouldn't.
Yeah. Right.
So we're just a backwards sort of folk.
You know? Right. Maybe just forgive and forget in the sense that you don't hold that against them anymore. Because you're right, it's hard for us to forget, but we can maybe in the essence of forgetting that I'm not going to hold this against you. I'm not going to let this come between us.
So how do you handle this? throw a monkey in the wrench. So Sean has borrowed $100 from me, and he didn't pay me back. And he said, man, I forgive me of that. Mm-hmm. Okay, so I forget. I'm not holding that against Sean anymore.
I don't have to pay
Sean
it back.
Sean comes and borrows $100 from me again, wants to.
Mm-hmm. I don't have to pay that
Do
back
I
either.
Remember to be careful with Sean?
That's right. Right.
And if I'm remembering to be careful with Sean, have I truly forgotten mm-hmm. what Sean has done?
Mm-hmm. Right. Well, don't be tempted to take it too far. And and speaking of that, that's something where the last phrase says of the prayer says, "Lead us not into temptation, mm-hmm. but deliver us from the evil one." And we don't necessarily have time to go there, but James 1:13 says God is incapable.
That's right.
He doesn't tempt us. And neither is he tempted. And so I think that's something that's really key also is that temptations come, but God is not the one who says, I want to tempt you. He sits back and allows the temptations to come, but we need to cling to him so that we don't yield to that temptation. Some people say, well, God tempted me. No, it's James 1:13. He says, I'm not capable of tempting. That's my own.
God leaves no one in temptation. Yeah.
Right. And so that's something that people need to understand also is that God is not the one doing the tempting. It's the devil that's doing the tempting.
Right.
But if you're not in God's will, then he can't protect you for that last part, but deliver us from the evil one.
Exactly.
Right. That's right.
And so it's interesting that the order of things here as well, because he says, up here, he says, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And then later we say, don't lead, but deliver us from the evil one. Mm-hmm. If we weren't in God's will, then God, we have tied God's hands from delivering us because we haven't asked him to.
Right. Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yep. Oh, yeah. In the end there.
But you know what? Jesus came for one reason. Jesus came to destroy the works of the devil.
To destroy the works of the devil.
Yeah.
So friends, as we come to the end of this program, we hope that you have spent some time with us. We pray that you will spend time with God, your Father, your Heavenly Father, who has taught us all how to pray, a prayer that develops relationship with him and brings us to rely on the love, the unyielding love that he has for us, his children. So thank you for spending this time with us today. We'll see you later.